Welcome. This is Accounting with Bennett Tchaikovsky. Our topic today is going to be non-current liabilities, bonds, and we're going to be recording interest expense. And this is when the bond is going to be issued at a discount, annual, semi-annual, with straight line amortization. This presentation is copyright 2008-2018 by Bennett Tchaikovsky. All rights are reserved. And so once a bond has been issued, we've already dealt with the issuance of the bond and figuring out that out using present value. What happens once a bond is issued? Well, what we're going to see happen is that this company is going to have to pay cash to the bondholders. And, you know, if it was as simple as a regular loan, I would be debiting interest expense and crediting cash. However, with bonds, because we're going to get questions that have when a bond was issued at a premium or at a discount, we need to figure out how to go through and, you know, essentially amortize that discount or premium to interest expense. And our goal is we want this discount or premium to ultimately be zero at the end of the day. So right over here is just to kind of, what is amortization? It's kind of similar to depreciation. However, amortization is generally used for non-physical assets. Really when we're talking about like intangibles, and then this is also for bond discounts and premiums. It's essentially taking an amount that's being recorded on our books and essentially writing it off over time. So one of the differences here in this particular example is that there are really two different ways in terms of amortizing a premium or a discount. There is the effective interest method and there is straight line. We're going to be doing straight line in these videos. We'll do effective interest a little bit later. The only difference between effective and straight line is when we're doing effective is we're really looking at that carrying value year over year and essentially going to be determining interest expense based on that, where the bond premium or discount is going to be kind of secondary. Here, we're kind of backing into interest expense because we're going to figure out the amount of cash we're paying the bond interest, the bond premium or discount amortization, and then getting into interest expense. So we're right now going to focus on straight line. The journal entries don't change. The journal entry I use to record interest expense under effective interest doesn't change between, you know, those two different methods. Really what is going to be changing are the dollar amounts. Notice one other thing here is in these examples, I'm telling you what the actual proceeds are, so you do not have to go through and do the computation. So let's look at our first example, an annual interest payment, straight line discount amortization. If a company issued a bond with a face value for $10 million on January 1st and received proceeds of $9 million, assuming the bond's term is 10 years, pays interest annually, and has a stated rate of interest of 7%, what is the journal entry to record interest expense for the end of the year? Now, the first thing we want to do is let's go back and look at that journal entry. And so here, by the way, it doesn't matter. When it comes to straight line amortization, the journal entries and the dollar amounts are all going to be the same. And that's because it's straight line, it doesn't change it. But when we issue this bond, how do I know it's at a discount? Because my proceeds are less than the face value. My bond, as you remember, is always recorded at face value. And here I'm getting my proceeds or my cash of $9 million. So that discount here is going to be the difference between the bonds payable and the cash received. Again, we did not go through and do the, you know, market rate of interest and say, now we're just going through this here because I really want you to focus on looking at how this kind of works. So again, our goal ultimately is going to have this discount on bonds payable ultimately go to zero. So in order for to make that happen, what I'm going to have to go through and do is when I'm doing the journal entry to record interest expense, I'm going to be debiting interest expense because we always debit our expenses. I'm going to credit discount on bonds payable. And why is that? Well, If I need discount on bonds payable to go to zero, gotta credit that balance. So we're gonna credit discount on bonds payable, and then we're gonna credit cash for the amount of interest expense that we're paying. This journal entry, when I'm doing interest expense, and if it's a discount on bonds payable, will never ever change. So the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna compute the cash paid for interest. In this scenario here, it was the bond's face value of $10 million times 7% gives me $700,000 per year. The next thing I need to figure out is what is my amortization of my bond discount. This is going to be the bond discount of $1 million. This is what I initially recorded when I had my transaction up here, $1 million. It's a 10-year bond, so it's paying interest 10 times. So every time I make a payment, I'm going to be amortizing it by 10, or basically by 100,000, where the bond discount divided by the number of times interest is being paid for a total of $100,000. Now for my journal entry, which again will never ever change, is I'm crediting cash for the interest that I'm paying. I'm crediting discount on bonds payable for the amount of the amortization. And my interest expense here is really just kind of a filler. It's this whatever we need to do to balance our equation, or $800,000. And again, this journal entry, I could be asking for, you know, December 31st, 2023 is not going to make a difference. So that's how we record interest expense when we're at a discount situation. And again, our key here is we want our discount ultimately to go to zero. So we're going to have to credit that discount on bonds payable. If I look at my second example, which is a semi-annual interest payment, straight line amortization. So here we had a company issued a bond with a face value of $20 million and received proceeds of $19.5 million. Assuming the bond's term is 20 years, pays interest semi-annually. I don't know why I wrote this out like this. Allie, and has a stated interest rate of 10%. What is the journal entry to record interest expense for the 6 months ended June 30th, 2025? Again, I could be asking you for any date of the week, any six month date. But let's first kind of go back and look at our journal entry. So here I had a credit to bonds payable, which will always be at the face value. My cash proceeds were $19.5 million. So here my discount is going to be $500,000. Remember, the discount is the difference between the bonds payable and the cash received. This journal entry for a discount on bonds payable in terms of issuance never changes. And remember, here my goal is to make the discount on bonds payable zero. And so my journal entry that I'm going to be using in terms of my format is going to be here a debit to interest expense, credit to discount on bonds payable, and a credit to cash. So to go through and complete the journal entry, what I need to do is I need to compute two amounts. What is my cash paid for interest? And what is the amortization of the bond discount? So my cash paid for interest, it will be the face value times the percentage of interest, times 6/12 or $1 million. My bond amortization is going to be the amount of my bond discount, or 500,000, divided by how many times am I paying interest. Now remember, oh, by the way, so let me go through this again. Cash paid for interest, 20 million times 10%, which is the annual interest rate per year, times 6/12. And why are we doing this by 6/12? Because the bond is paying semi-annually. Whenever we see an interest rate, it is always an annual interest rate, always annual. So I got to multiply that factor by 6/12. So right over here, right, that's my $1 million. Then I need to amortize the discount. So my bond discount was 500 grand. But how many times am I paying interest over the life of the bond? Well, assuming that the term is 20 years, and if it's semi-annual, 20 years, twice per year, there's my 40, or the math that I absolutely love in accounting. So I'm going to take that 500,000 divided by 40, I'm going to get 12,500. So my journal entry here is going to be a credit to cash of $1 million, a credit to discount on bonds payable of $12,500. And then I'm going to be debiting interest expense for $1,012,500. And again, this journal entry will be the same every single time. And in fact, I think I asked for a more bizarre date. And so what's a journal entry record interest expense for the 6 months ended June 30th, 2025? Here, I'm just going to go ahead and say, all right, 6/30/25. There we go. I could say any one of the dates in those 20 years will always be the same because the discount is being amortized straight line. Okay. Now we're going to get to our next part here, which is talking about the bond carrying value in terms of the balance sheet presentation. Now, we looked at in our last segments, one of the last things I finished up with is that on that January 1st date of the issuance, we had a bond payable less discount gives me bonds payable net. But what if I were to ask you, what is the carrying value of the bond as of a certain date? Do I need to go through and, you know, create these T account or create a transaction for every time? The answer is no. What I'm going to do here is when I'm going through, I know that the journal entry for this question, right? This is the same one we were doing before. Journal entry here is never going to change. Again, company issues a bond with a face value of $20 million on January 1st, receive proceeds of $19,500. Assume the bond's term is 20 years, pays interest semi-annually. And God, I've made this thing again. Wow. There we go. Good job, Tchaikovsky. And a stated interest rate of 10%, prepare the balance sheet presentation. Remember my cash paid for interest, 20 million times 10% or 2 million times 6/12 gives me the million. And then that discount is being amortized over 40 periods because it's a 20-year bond paying interest semi-annually. And this is asking me for what is the balance sheet presentation as of June 30th, 2023. And when I'm asking for the balance sheet presentation, what this is really saying is I've got bonds payable less the discounts on bonds payable gives me bonds payable net, and this is going to be as of 6/30/23. How do I do it? Well, my discount on bonds payable on January 1st, 2019 was $500,000. So my very first interest payment was going to be on June 30th, 2019. How much should I amortize the discount on that date? $12,500. Why? The number here never changes. It doesn't matter what date I'm doing this for. What about on December 31st? It's the same. June 30th, it's the same. December 31st, it's the same. The same, the same, the same, the same. And then I get down to here. Now, you might be saying, oh, Tchaikovsky, I could just write here 2019 and I can write 25,000. The reason why I like to write this out is that if I do this correctly, I always will get the answer correct. And so that's why I like this kind of fun right here, because I know I'm going to get the correct answer. So what is my unamortized discount on bonds payable? Well, I had an opening balance here of 500,000, and then I made all these interest payments right here. And so my ending balance on discount on bonds payable is going to be 387,500. So my bonds payable, what was that amount? Well, my bonds payable had an amount of 20 million. And so my unamortized discount on bonds payable is going to be less 387,500. So my bonds payable net is going to be 19,612,500. And if I compare this here to 1/1/19, when this bond was originally issued, which was basically had a $500,000 discount, and I'm comparing this to this, what's happening here? Well, what's going on is that this bond is slowly being written up to the magical number of 20 million that will be paid upon the bond's maturity. So when you're doing these problems, it's kind of a way to check if you want to kind of say, hey, am I doing this right? this is what you want to do. I will always tell students that make sure you do this chart like this here, because you want to get the right answer, and using a T account in this situation is definitely the best way to do it. So with that being said, thank you for watching my video today. Make sure to like and subscribe, and I will see you on the next fun accounting video that will be looking at it from the premium perspective. Thank you so much.